on? There we go. Good morning, Bearcats. Great to see you all this morning. Hope everyone was able to pick up a Bible this morning as you came in. Those are from the Gideons. That's a New Testament, which is good news today because our speaker is going to be speaking out of the book of John. So everyone has a Bible this morning. Remember to bring a Bible and a notebook when you come to chapel. It's a great way for you to engage and get connected. You guys are doing a great job in filling in. There are some folks that are still coming in. There are some seats down front here. In fact, on this side as well, on some side. Make sure when you come in, you kind of scoot toward the middle, especially this way, so people coming on the sides, they can fill in. So continue to work on that. Hey, let's give it up for our women's volleyball. They picked up their first win. Great job, ladies. They beat Oklahoma Christian University. They beat them 3-2. Great job, ladies. And our men's soccer is playing the same group, Oklahoma Christian University, at home this Wednesday at 4:30. So be there. Does anyone know if it's at Plaster Stadium, if it's over on the soccer field? At the soccer field. Soccer field at 4:30. Be there. That's going to be a great time. Today, I want to welcome and introduce our speaker, Dr. Dan DeWitt. Dr. DeWitt has joined us here at SBU. He is the director for our Center for Worldview and Culture. Some of you heard him speak this past spring. He did a C.S. Lewis event last year. He's going to be doing a special event tonight, which he'll tell you about. Dr. DeWitt is a dear friend, wonderful part of our SBU community. You're going to enjoy getting to know him. There's going to be a lot of opportunities, some trips to Boston, including a trip to England, some opportunities for every student to be involved in worldview analysis and cultural engagement. So how do we learn about what others believe, what we believe? How can we winsomely share the gospel and engage culture? So you're going to really enjoy that tonight. His event tonight has coffee and donuts, so you'll definitely want to be there. It'll be a great time together. This morning, if you would, join me. If you're part of the track team and cross-country team, you might already know this. Coach McElhaney had something at the doctor's office this morning where they were going to do a stent that didn't work out, and it looks like there could be some more serious complications of things that they need to look into with his heart. So let's just pray right now for Coach McElhaney. I don't know all the details. Gage reached out this morning. I just know a little bit, so that procedure didn't go as planned. And, you know, sometimes we just don't know those circumstances. So let's just pray for the doctors, the nurses. But most important, let's remember that God is Jehovah Rapha, which means the God who heals. And let's just pray for divine healing over Coach Mack this morning as we join together. This is the day the Lord has made. So we are going to rejoice and be glad in it, even in challenging and difficult circumstances. So would you stand? I'm going to pray for Coach Mack. Then we're going to sing and worship together. Father, we come to you this morning knowing that you are the God who heals, that you are the great physician, and we just pray to you this morning, not even knowing all of the other circumstances, but as Gage reminded us this morning for Coach Mack, I just pray right now for whatever the procedure was that didn't go as planned, whatever maybe the circumstances might be that would require additional procedures and other things that they need to do. I just pray for the nurses and the surgeons and the doctors that are involved, that you would give them wisdom and discernment. And God, that you would bring supernatural healing, that you would heal his body, and that the next time he goes in, they would open the body and they would say, we don't even have to do this because you have been healed of whatever you're working through. So God, I don't know all the details. You do. We trust you in that. I pray for Gage and other family members. I pray for the team whose coach is out right now, and just pray that you would be with them. And God, we just love you and thank you that we are a part of a community, that we are the body of Christ, and we can lift up each person here in this room. And there may be other things that people in this room are dealing with right now, and I just pray, God, that you would comfort them with your healing, that you would provide for them, that you would put your arms in and around them and care for them and know that they are cared for, that we are the body, that we can care for one another, that we can share each other's burdens. And God, we just cast this burden upon you this morning. And even as we worship, Father, I pray that you would begin a healing process in our lives, in Coach Mack's life. And God, as we come together, that we would center our minds' attention and hearts' affections on you, that we would worship together, that you would open our ears to hear the word as Dr. DeWitt comes this morning. And God, that you would equip us to go out and make a difference in the world for Jesus Christ. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. All God's people said, amen. Let's worship together.
guys will go ahead and pray with me before we get into the message today. Dear Lord, we just thank you for the ability to gather in this place together today, God. Lord, we don't take for granted how special it is to be under the same roof as the same body, connected by you and you alone, Lord. Lord, I pray for this message today. I pray that our hearts would be open to what you have to say to us. Lord, that scripture would speak for itself. Lord, that we would just be in awe of who you are and what your word has to say for us in our lives. Lord, I pray that we would take seriously this time, that we wouldn't be distracted, Lord, that you would focus in our minds, focus in our hearts, and allow us to just praise, allow us to be thankful, allow us to be focused on you. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and it's in your name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. When I say, how's it going, you say, it's all good. How's it going? So it's great to be with you, and I'm honored at the opportunity to join the team here at SBU. And so how many of you were in chapel or at the C.S. Lewis event last year I spoke at? Anybody there? So I see a few hands. So did not know I was here interviewing, but the Lord had other plans. So here just 4 months later, to be a part of what the Lord's doing here is awesome. I think the world of Dr. Melson, the best thing about Dr. Melson is his wife, Tammy. And speaking of one's family, I have my family with me. I'm so honored to have my parents take time to drive over from Illinois. And so if you would give a welcome to my parents, Nanette and Wendell, right down here. Right here. And then my family, my wife and I have been married 21 years this summer. We're going to, thank you. And we're going to celebrate our anniversary here in a couple weeks on a trip. We're going to Michigan. So they are here, April, and then Isaiah, Micah, Josiah, and Addie. So please welcome them as well. All right, so before we open up the word, I want to tell you a little bit about what I'll be doing on campus. And so I'm going to be leading a center, and it is called the Center for Worldview and Culture. And the center, hopefully, the goal will be, is to be a resource for you, to help you as you work through your own faith, as you work through doubts and questions and then concerns about how to effectively share the gospel with people who think you're crazy. And so that's what the center will exist for. We're going to talk about things like worldview, apologetics, theology, and philosophy. And so one of the things that the center will do is every month we will have an apologetics seminar. And so we'll do three or four of these this semester. The very first event we'll do is tonight. So I'd love for you to join us. We're going to have free donuts and free coffee. And the title of the event is Christianity Good? This is the first talk that I'll give in a series on exploring Christianity. And the second talk is Christianity Rational? And the final talk is Christianity True? Now, just a word about these seminars, just so you know what to expect. We will start on time, and so tonight it starts at 9 o'clock in the Student Union, and we will end on time. So it'll be an hour long, and I will make sure that we both start and end on time each time. And then whoever's speaking, in this case it'll be me, the speaker will stay after as long as people want to keep talking, but we'll actually dismiss everybody. So you know when you come that you're not going to be like held. Have you ever been at an event where you're kind of like held hostage and it just keeps going? So we will stop right at the end of the hour, dismiss everybody, and then if you want to hang out a bit longer, you can. So that's tonight, is Christianity Good in the Student Union? I'll tell you about one more thing. That, as Dr. Melson mentioned, we're going to do a lot of things with the center. We're going to have trips. In time, there's going to be a certificate in worldview studies that you could get. But I'll tell you about one more thing now, and that is a weekly live streaming Q&A session. I'm going to call it Theo Latte Live. Theo Latte is like the combination of coffee and theology. And so every Friday at 10 a.m. we'll be streaming an event. I'm going to be responding to your questions. And then I'll also teach through a little bit of teaching time through a book every semester. The book I'm going to do this semester is called The Consequences of Ideas by an author I really appreciate whose name's R.C. Sproul. So join us. You can go for any information about the center, just go to the university website /worldview, and you can find more details about that. All right, what I want to talk about today and on Wednesday, and to be honest, as many times as Dr. Melson lets me speak in chapel this year, So I know I'll be back in October. I think every time I speak this year, I just want to be in John's gospel and focus on an encounter that people have with Jesus. Jesus was a remarkable historical figure. Of course, we believe that he's more than just an influential leader, but he's certainly not less than that. And what I want to look at is the way that Jesus talked to people and the way that Jesus impacted their lives. And so today, the very first encounter we're going to look at is John chapter 3. So I know you all have Bibles. Let's give it up for the Gideons for giving everybody Bibles on your way in. Stedman will say a bit more about that at the end of the chapel hour. Turn to John chapter 3. This encounter I'm describing as one takeaway point is that Jesus doesn't love the fake us. Jesus doesn't love the version of you that you project out that isn't an honest reflection of who you really are. And I don't say that to make you feel bad. I don't think that all of us have to air all of our, you know, dirty laundry. I don't think we have to go around kind of blurting out all of our struggles and our anxieties. But the reality is Jesus doesn't love the fake you. Jesus didn't die for the fake you. The one that you carefully kind of have this curated social media projection of who you want people to think you are. Jesus doesn't love that version of you. But he loves the real you. The real you, when you're being completely as honest as you can be with yourself and with God, with all the guards down, with no attempt to impress anyone, that's the you Jesus is after. And I think if we're honest, that's the version of us that we don't think anybody's going to like. The real us is the version of us that's not photoshopped and it's not airbrushed. And our deepest fear is that that version of us, which is the real us, that God doesn't love that us. I think of the country music song that I heard recently that says, at first God's going to hate me, but eventually he'll save me. Anybody know what song I'm talking about? I don't know the title of it. I think a lot of us live like that. At first God's going to hate us, but in time we could kind of win him over. We could show him that we're worth loving. The Bible puts it exactly opposite. It says that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So we're going to see an encounter where Jesus refuses, absolutely refuses, to deal with the fake version of a man whose name is Nicodemus. So I'll have the words on the screen as well. Let's read these first three verses and then pray. There was a man from the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus at night and said, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform these signs that you do unless God were with him. Jesus replied, truly I tell you, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Let's pray. God, we ask that you would honor your word in our presence, and we pray that you would demonstrate the power of the gospel to save, even today. Lord, I pray for the student here who really doesn't feel lovable, and they're really afraid for anyone, perhaps most of all you, to know who they really are. And I pray that today, if nothing else, that they will have just a very real sense, an acute awareness that you know them and you love them, and that Jesus died for the real them. I pray that you bless our time together and that you would glorify your Son in our midst. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So it's the Feast of Passover in Jerusalem. It's a really busy time. Perhaps that's why Nicodemus goes to Jesus at night. If the city would have been busy, it would have been difficult to make his way across town to find Jesus. In fact, Jesus, many people, as we read in John's gospel in John chapter 2, many people are already believing in Jesus. So Jesus is already getting a lot of attention at a time that people are already kind of filling the city streets. Maybe that's why Nicodemus shows up late at night. Maybe it's because he was embarrassed. He didn't want his other religious leaders to know he was coming to Jesus. But the one thing we see in these verses is that Jesus is not distracted by flattery. I think I'm a guy, and I think that most guys are easily distracted by flattery. like, hey, I like your shoes. Oh, let me tell you where I bought them. And, you know, even if I'm angry about something, you know, it's like, I'll be happy to respond to your flattery. Jesus is not, on the other hand, Jesus is not at all distracted by flattery. So Nicodemus is like, hey, you're a great teacher. God's doing some amazing things through you. Jesus doesn't say, well, thank you for that. I appreciate that. He doesn't lift his finger towards heaven and kind of bow his head. You know, it's all the Father doing this. No, Jesus looks at Nicodemus and simply says, you must be born again. I wonder if Jesus were to sit down with you today, if he may not say the same words. Perhaps you've never had a life-transforming encounter with Jesus, what we would describe as conversion. And so you've been around this kind of stuff a lot, or maybe you kind of would just admit, I don't believe in God, I don't believe in Jesus. Whatever the case is, I wonder if that would be the same conversation Jesus would have with you today. Whatever you tell him, whatever you project about yourself, he knows your heart. And perhaps Jesus would say to you, you need new life. You need to be born again. The reality is you could fool everyone, but you can't fool him. Sometimes I think in settings like this, I have the opportunity to speak at youth camps and youth conferences, and I often like to kind of go after the senior high school guys because they're putting on this front, and there's an assumption that the preaching and the gospel and the music and even God is somehow for like the middle school girls, but not for them. I mean, when we talk about things like this, this is for other people, it's not for you. But what if Jesus would say to you today, you must be born again? I want to read the following verses and then just give you some takeaways to think about. Jesus cuts through the facade and tells Nicodemus not what he wants to hear, but what he needs to hear. Look at the next verses. Don't leave. Don't scan out now. All right, let me go back. So verse, I've got a quick trigger finger here. There we go. Nicodemus responds to Jesus. This is a rather odd statement. I mean, he's a religious leader. He doesn't use this kind of language. Jesus is introducing to him a concept that he's not entirely aware of. And so he goes through the collection of his lived experiences. And he thinks, well, how can I be born again? How does a person accomplish this? And so Nicodemus thinks to himself, I would imagine, I was born once. Is it kind of like that? And if we're being totally honest, you all have to recognize here, and we're all adults, that you contributed absolutely nothing to your birth. Zero. What did you contribute to your birth? Nothing. You know, your parents had a romantic evening 9 months before your birthday, your first birthday. And then you're born. You come into the world kicking and screaming, and you did nothing to contribute to it. And Nicodemus is like, Jesus, you said I have to be born again. I was born once. Is it kind of like that? So he asked Jesus, how can I be born when I'm old? Can a man enter his mother's womb a second time and be born? Well, that sounds rather gross. I imagine the disciples are like in the back either laughing or like trying not to like mouth vomit. You know that it is, right? It's a gross sensation. And Jesus responds to him. Jesus kind of takes his question, and Nicodemus is confused. He's trying to put it in like a context of something he can relate to. Can I be born again? And Jesus makes it worse. So Jesus says, truly I tell you, unless someone is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. And I'm sure Nicodemus is like, that didn't help. Whatever is born of the flesh is flesh. Whatever is born of the Spirit is spirit. So don't miss this point. What Jesus tells Nicodemus is he has to be born again. Nicodemus asks a question, and Jesus is essentially telling him, there's nothing you could do. You can't do it. Can I go back to my mother's womb? No, Jesus says you're misunderstanding the point. This has to be a work of the Spirit. Now, some of you are like, well, that sounds a lot like Reformed theology, or that sounds like whatever this ism, this ology that maybe you don't like. This is just Jesus telling Nicodemus something we know really well. We can't save ourselves. We can't. You've been working on yourself for what, 18, 19, 20 years? Let me ask you this. How's it working out for you? We all know that our efforts can't save ourselves. And so Jesus tells them it has to be a work of God. Now we'll look at the next few verses and I'll give you some takeaway. Jesus tells Nicodemus, don't be amazed that I told you you must be born again. The wind blows where it pleases and you hear its sound, but you don't know where it comes from or where it's going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. Jesus is showing Nicodemus that unless the Spirit of God is to do something miraculous in his heart, he cannot have life. Nicodemus contributed nothing to his first birth, and it would seem in this passage he really can't accomplish his new birth on his own either. And Jesus tells him it's like the wind. You can't control the wind. The Spirit blows wherever it wants, and you can't control the Spirit. After, I think, 20 years of hearing cell phones ring. After like 20 years of preaching at youth camps, I've learned this to be true. You cannot control the Spirit of God. And we do all that we can with youth ministry. Any youth ministry people in the house, like we do what we can do. Like we get the fog machines and the laser lights and the songs, like, you know, they have that one point in the song where it just like steps up a whole nother emotional level. And I'm not against any of those things, like bringing on the laser lights and, you know, the pizza, all you can eat pizza thing, like do it all, right? But we can't control the Spirit. Here's another thing I've learned. You can't stop the Spirit. You can't control it and you can't stop it. Here's what Dr. Melson and the team here, the faculty, the staff, are praying for, that the Spirit will blow in like the wind and do a powerful work in our midst. And I don't know where you're at or how you might describe your spiritual position today, but just know this, that God knows the real you, and if the Spirit wants to blow in and disrupt your plans and disrupt your life, there's nothing you could do to stop it. And that's exactly what we're praying for. Nicodemus says, how can these things be? And Jesus says, how are you a religious leader, a teacher of Israel, and you don't know these things? Now we're working our way to one of the most famous verses in all of the New Testament. Jesus tells him, truly I tell you, we speak what we know and we testify what we have seen, but you do not accept our testimony. Why is it that Nicodemus has not experienced the Spirit? Why is it that Nicodemus has not accepted or experienced new life? Because he rejects the testimony of Jesus. Jesus goes on to say, if I had told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And then he gives an Old Testament reference from Numbers chapter 21, I believe. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness. If you remember that Old Testament story where the children of Israel were complaining about the menu. They were tired of eating what God was feeding them. And so God sent snakes, fiery snakes into their midst. And the snakes were biting them and they were dying from the snake bites. And God told Moses to take a snake and to make a snake rather and put it on a stick and to hold it up. And to tell the nation of Israel that everyone who looked at that snake would be healed. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up so that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world in this way, he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Now, just as an aside, often we read this and we think, oh, this is talking about Jesus being lifted up on the cross. I actually think it's talking about Jesus ascending into heaven. The reference here is the ascension, and I think in Jesus being accepted by the Father after the resurrection, that is the completed work of Christ. Christ is now seated at the right hand of God, praying for you right now, interceding for you right now. And the Spirit who does his bidding perhaps is even working now. We can't control it and we can't stop it. But if we look to Jesus, we can live. Here's the final verse we'll look at today. Anyone who believes in him, Jesus, is not condemned. But anyone who does not believe is already condemned because he has not believed in the name of the one and only Son of God. What can Nicodemus do? He can't control the spirit. He can't climb back in his mother's womb. He can't produce this new life. What can he do? What can you do? You can believe. And there's this weird way in which we'd say when someone believes that it's the Spirit of God working for them to believe. But there's a real fact that you have to believe. How does that work? I don't know. I get nervous when I'm around people who say they've figured all that out. This is a mystery we don't fully get. But the Spirit of God has to be at work, and you have to believe. And when you believe, you're no longer condemned. I would want to beg you, young man, young woman, to consider Jesus. I don't know what your experiences have been. I don't know why you're here. I don't know how you feel about your relationship with God. But I do know this. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, a judgment. The Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 2 describes people who don't have a relationship with God as an object of wrath. And I think what Paul's getting at there is on the day you stand before God, if you've never had a life-transforming encounter with Jesus, on the day you stand before God, there will be nothing that God will have to give to you except for wrath because you refused his son. Let me give you three quick takeaways. First of all, Jesus cuts through our facades. Nicodemus shows up with flattery. He's a religious leader who's trying to protect his reputation, but he's curious. He has a gnawing question that drives him to seek out this rebel from Nazareth, even in the darkness of night, to ask him questions about God the Father. Jesus cuts through our facade. Jesus sees the real you. Maybe you're like Nicodemus and you have a kind of a religious facade. You've been around church for a long time and you don't even need to think about this stuff. You're good. Or maybe you have a skeptical facade. I don't believe in God, you might think. I'm not saying that for myself. But maybe that's you. And if that is you, I would love to talk, not because I think I can argue into becoming a Christian. In fact, I may not have answers to your biggest questions, but I would just love to talk. But maybe you'd say, my facade is I'm a skeptic and I've got it all figured out, but deep down you know there's these lingering questions that just won't seem to go away. Jesus cuts through our facades like a laser cuts through fog. He dispels the mist that we put around us to distract people from who we truly are. There's no hiding with God. But the good news is that's the you God's after. That's the you Jesus died for, the you try to protect from everyone else. That's the real you Jesus loves. Here's the second takeaway. Jesus calls us to belief. The passage almost seems hopeless, doesn't it? You have to do something you can't do. You can't be born again. You can't control the wind. You can't control the spirit. What can Nicodemus do? Nicodemus can believe. And of course, when he believes, we'll say this is evidence that the spirit is at work. It's a great mystery, but I would say to you, whatever your facade is, that Jesus is calling you to believe on the name of the only Son of God. And everyone who believes experiences a new birth, a new life. Here's the final takeaway. Jesus cares for our soul. Jesus is telling Nicodemus how Nicodemus can deal with that deep down guilt and shame that he can't make go away on his own. Jesus cares for Nicodemus's soul, and he's telling him how to get free of the burden of condemnation. To look to Jesus as the Israelites look to the bronze image of the snake being lifted up by Moses. To look to Jesus and to live. One of my favorite authors, as you'll learn and probably have already figured out, is C.S. Lewis. Many years ago, your parents and grandparents would be familiar with, America and Russia were in a space race. And we were really trying, in fact, President Kennedy was really committed to trying to beat the Russians, and we weren't successful. They sent a man into space before us. They sent a guy named Yuri Gagarin. But they just were able to send him into space and bring him back successfully. No doubt a massive feat, impressive, but we sent a man to the moon, right? Go America. And we did what only Americans would do. We got to the moon and we planted a flag on it and claimed it as our own, right? But when the Russians sent a man into space, Yuri Gagarin, when he came back, everybody wanted to talk to him because no one had ever done anything like that before. In one interview, and I'll get back to why I mentioned C.S. Lewis, C.S. Lewis responded to something he said. Yuri Gagarin, in one interview, was asked about his experience, and he said, we've been to space, and we didn't see God, and we didn't see heaven in outer space. And I don't think he was being literal. I don't think he meant that he was actually thinking he was going to look outside of the window, you know, and like there would be God. Like with his arms kind of in a shrug, like, what? Why are you up here? I put you down there. I don't think he thought he was going to look out and see the streets of the gold streets of heaven or something like that. I think he meant something a bit more like this. The Bible didn't teach us how to build a rocket to send a man into outer space. We did this. This is a human accomplishment. This is us. This is a human endeavor. This is a human accomplishment. C.S. Lewis, who was alive at the time, just had to respond. And so he wrote an essay called The Seeing Eye, like eyeball. And in that essay, he said, you know, it's kind of silly to think we're going to find God somewhere in the material universe, like you might find a rock or a tree. God is not a material object in the material universe, just by definition of who God is. He's immaterial, and thinking we're going to find him out in the desert or the bottom of the ocean or as far as we can get in space is kind of silly. We don't relate to God the way one might relate to a physical object, like, say, this podium. We're not going to find God in a way that we can measure him and touch him physically. C.S. Lewis said, no, it's more like responding to the creator of a play than it is in responding to God as a physical object. So he used this illustration. He said, imagine if Shakespeare made a similar declaration. Shakespeare being created by, or not Shakespeare rather, but Hamlet being created as a created character by Shakespeare. If Hamlet were to say, I've been to the attic of my home, and I didn't see God, and I didn't see heaven. Ergo, therefore, there's no God. There's no heaven. That would be kind of silly, wouldn't it? The fact that Hamlet couldn't find the author of his story inside of the world that the author of his story made wouldn't prove the author doesn't exist. Now, on one hand, if we're being honest, Hamlet is not going to find physical evidence of Shakespeare anywhere in his world, right? He's not going to find Shakespeare's slippers under the bed. He's not going to find Shakespeare's journal sitting on the dining room table. He's not going to find his pipe, you know, sitting in an easy chair or something like that. There is zero physical evidence for Shakespeare in all of Hamlet's world. On the other hand, all of Hamlet's world is evidence of Shakespeare. Hamlet wouldn't have a world unless it were for Shakespeare. C.S. Lewis went on to say, the only way Hamlet could ever know Shakespeare, the author of his story, is if Shakespeare wrote himself into the plot. The only way that Hamlet could know Shakespeare is if Shakespeare wrote himself into the story. What is Jesus saying to Nicodemus here? He says that God loves you so much, he wrote himself into the story. He sent his son so that you could know God and you could have life. Whatever your facade is today, God sent his son to save the real you. Not a fake version of you, not the Instagram version of you, or the Snapchat version of you, or the Facebook. I know you guys don't really Facebook. That's like your grandparents' thing now. But Jesus came to save the real you. And if you'll look to him today, you'll have life. I'll close with a story. I used to lead a ministry. I'm on a secular campus at the University of Louisville. We met in a building called the Red Barn, and we shared the building with the LGBTQ plus student organization. We were the only two student orgs in the building. And it was a blast getting to meet students who didn't believe in God, students who were far from God, to do Bible studies. We ended every sermon, not with an invitation, but with Q&A. I would finish preaching, and then we'd have open mics. And I had a couple students who wanted to meet, so I went down to campus and met them at the coffee shop. And one student, I'll just call him Scott. He's originally from Asia. Scott had been coming to our Bible study for a while and wanted to meet, and he brought a friend with him. His friend's name was Clay. His friend Clay was from America and was a second or third generation atheist. His parents weren't believers. I don't think his grandparents were believers. And that's kind of uncommon in America. Usually most of the atheists you meet in America are first generation atheists. And so I'm there to meet with Scott, and Scott is as quiet as a middle school kid when you ask him how their day was. You know what I'm talking about? You get one-word answers to everything. But his friend was loquacious, which means chatty. And so I finally, turned just to talk to his friend, because the guy I was really there to meet with was not talking. He was not helping at all. So I'm talking to this, third-generation atheist, and he's asking really good questions, questions like, how do we know there's a God? Why did God make the world? Why is the world so evil? Why is there so much struggling? And really good questions. So I'm answering his questions, doing the very best that I could do, just like you would if you were there. And at one point, he finally says to me, he says, you know, what you've said makes some sense. In fact, it makes sense that there would be something like God for the world to even have a beginning. It makes sense that there is a God, but there's so many religions in the world. Even if you convince me that there's a God, and I think some of your arguments make it sound like maybe there's a God, but there's so many different ways that people worship God. If there really is a God, why doesn't he just come down and say, this is the one true way? And I paused for a moment because I wanted him to feel like I was taking his question seriously. I didn't want to just respond. But it felt like one of those questions that was like a softball question. I forget who the baseball player was. I think maybe Babe Ruth, who would point to where he was going to hit the home run. Do you know what I'm talking about? I kind of felt like that, I'm going to hit it right out of the park right there. This is an easy one. And so I paused, and I'm trying to show that I'm taking it seriously. And then Scott, who's barely said a single word the whole time, fills the silence by saying, duh, Jesus. And that really is the truth of all of Christianity. If there's a God who really exists, wouldn't he just come down and say, this is the one true way? Here's what Jesus is saying to Nicodemus. He has. Why? Because he loves you so much, the real you. He's come that you might have life. Let's pray. God, thank you for, above all things, Jesus coming into the world to save sinners. Lord, we desperately need the gospel to be true. And we thank you for the most beautiful thing of all, that it really is. I pray for students who may be struggling with this truth, that you might open their eyes, that the Spirit, like the wind, might blow through this building today, changing lives, opening eyes and ears, to receive new life. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Will you stand as we continue to worship?
For me, I see his wounds. His so awesome. Hey guys, we want to let you know that Daniel DeWitt's going to be here all week. He'll be leading our fall Bible conference, Encounters with Jesus. So he'll be in chapel again teaching Wednesday, and we encourage you to come tonight at 9 p.m. for the student union for him going over, is Christianity good? Understand this, he's teaching through Encounters with Jesus in hopes and in prayers that you would have an encounter with Jesus, that you would drop the facade. You're more of a sinner than you know, and you're more loved than you can hope for. More of a sinner than you know, more loved you can hope for. On your way in, you received a New Testament from Gideon's. Now, I understand most of you already have Bibles, so I want to challenge you with this. There are people in your life that you probably know who do not know the goodness of God, who aren't walking in a relationship with him. And I want to challenge you. There is a plan of salvation in the back after Psalms and Proverbs. There's helps in the front. It would be awesome if you can write a note to that person and gift them this. Don't let this Bible just pick up dust. Let it do what God has designed it to do, to move in their hearts and call them to repentance that they may know the goodness of God. Guys, we love you. We hope you have an encounter with Jesus each and every day. You are dismissed. Please sign out.